بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا كما أمر، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إرغاما لمن جحد وكفر، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى أصحابه ما اتصلت عين بنظر وسمعت أذن بخبر. أما بعد، the last 2 weeks we've been going over the sunan of wudu. And the author started them off by saying, وَالْمُسْتَحَبُّ The recommended acts of wudu are غَسْلُ مَا بِهِ مِنْ أَذَى Washing off any filth. Number two is وَالْوُضُوء Performing wudu. Number three is washing the hands or the body thrice. وَالْغَسْلُ ثَلَاثًا And we took those three the week before the last. Last week we began on الدلك. وَالدَّلْكُ And we mentioned, which is rubbing the body with the hand and water. We mentioned whether that was wajib or not. And then we mentioned whether it's even sunnah or not. And after that, the fifth sunnah that we took of the ghusl is وَالتَّيَامُنُ Beginning the washing with the right side. And we took as proof for that, the hadith that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam started with the right side of the head, specifically mentioning the right side of the head. Then, the second proof is hadith Atiyyah radiallahu anha, when she was washing the daughter of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Zainab radiallahu anha. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered that Atiyyah start with the right side. Then we mention, as proof, the third hadith, which is the general hadith on preference of starting on the right side. The sixth sunnah is وَالتَّسْمِيَةُ mentioning the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We mentioned the dispute of the ulama pertaining to this, and some ulama said it's sunnah, some said it's not even sunnah, and some said it's wajib. And there's no direct, specific, authentic, explicit proof on this matter in ghusl, other than the athar that I mentioned of Ya'la ibn Umayyah, where he stated that Umar radiallahu anhu mentioned the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before pouring water over his head when he was covering him with a curtain. The seventh sunnah, which we'll start on today inshallah, is وَتَخْلِيلُ الشَّعْرِ That running the fingers through the hair to saturate the roots of the hair with water. وَتَخْلِيلُ الشَّعْرِ There's several ahadith that establish the sunnah. And that is the opinion of three of the four ulama, Hanafiyya, Shafi'iyya, and Hanabila. And some statements from the Malikiyya infer that they adopted, some of them adopt this opinion as well. The second opinion is another opinion within the Malikiyya madhab that it's wajib, it's obligatory. The proof establishing this is many of the hadith that we went over several times. Hadith Aisha describing the ghusl of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ثُمَّ يُخَلِّلُ بِيَدِهِ شَعْرَهُ The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ran his fingers through his hair. He rubbed his hair with his fingers until he felt the skin of the head has become wet. In a different wording of the narration, of Hadith Aisha in Sahih Bukhari. ثُمَّ يُدْخِلُ أَصَابِعَهُ فِي الْمَاء فَيُخَلِّلُ بِهَا أُصُولَ شَعْرِ He would put his fingers in water and then he would move his fingers in the roots of his hair. In another narration by Aisha radiallahu anha in Sahih Muslim, ثُمَّ يَأْخُذُ الْمَاءَ فَيُدْخِلُ أَصَابِعَهُ فِي أُصُولِ الشَّعْرِ He took some water and he moved his fingers through the roots of his hair, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ibn Rajab in Sharh Sahih Bukhari, he mentioned how important of a sunnah this is and how ulama valued such details. Details that are widely neglected today. He said, as much as ulama spoke or wrote pertaining to the sunan of ghusl and elaborated on it, This is one mighty great sunnah of ghusl. Many of them were mindless of. He said the only two, he's possibly talking about his time that he found. He said the only two who clearly mentioned it is in Al-Muhadhab from the Shafi'iyya and in Al-Mughni from the Hanabila. In ghusl, in purification from menstruation, the same sunnah applies. In fact, it's stressed by the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because hadith Asma, that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam told her to pour water over her head and rub vigorously so that the water reaches the roots of her hair. ثُمَّ تَصُبُّ عَلَى رَأْسِهَا فَتَدْلُكُهُ دَلْكًا شَدِيدًا حَتَّى تَبْلُغَ شُؤُونَ رَأْسِهَا. Malikiyya, we said, have two opinions on this. One is to consider takhleel of the sha'r wajib. The second opinion is with the rest of the ulama that it's only sunnah. Their specific statement on it being a sunnah is that one doesn't have to do the takhleel of the hair. And that's why I said it's possibly an opinion of theirs. That statement could mean two things. If they mean one doesn't have to do it as a wajib, but rather as a sunnah, possibly responding to others within their madhab who adopt the opinion that it's wajib, then that's correct and accurate, and that's the opinion of the jumhur, the majority of the ulama. But if they mean by that statement that one doesn't have to do the takhleel of the hair, that one doesn't have to do it at all, then the many hadith we just mentioned established that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it, and that's more than sufficient to respond and show that it is actually a sunnah. What's the proofs to support the jumhur, the majority, that it's sunnah? The previous ahadith that I just mentioned, that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam did the takhleel of the sha'r. What's the proofs to counter one of the opinions within the Maliki madhab alleging it's wajib? Number one, there's a hadith that mentioned the description of the wudu of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam without mentioning takhleel of the sha'r, and that's sufficient to show it's not wajib. Most of the proofs we mentioned last week pertaining to dalk not being wajib in ghusl, and most of the similar proofs we took the week before last to counter the Zahiriyya in their claim that wudu is wajib before ghusl, those same proofs are proofs we can use now to show that takhleel of the sha'r is not wajib. What ahadith are those? Refreshing your memory, like hadith Jabir radiallahu anhu, describing the wudu of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. كَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَأْخُذُ ثَلَاثَةَ أَكُفٍ وَيُفِيضُهَا عَلَى رَأْسِهِ ثُمَّ يُفِيضُ عَلَى سَائِرِ جَسَدِهِ. Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu said, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to take three handfuls of water. Then he would pour those handfuls over his head, and then pour more water over his body. That hadith has no mention of takhleel of the sha'r, which we're talking about right now. Just like we said in the past weeks, that there's no mention of it in wudu. And there's no mention of wudu in it. There's no mention of dalk in it. So that means that takhleel and dalk and wudu are not wajib. In Bukhari, in the long hadith that I mentioned, that there was a man who was junub, and then there was no water, then they found water, then the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him a pot of water, and he said to that man, pour this over your body. اذهب فأفرغه عليك. He said to him, take this water and pour it over yourself. That's all he had to do. He didn't mention wudu. He didn't mention takhleel. And he didn't mention dalk. And likewise, hadith Salama that we took, إِنَّمَا يَكْفِيكِ أَن تَحْثِي عَلَى رَأْسِكِ ثَلَاثَ حَثَيَاتِ ثُمَّ تُفِيضِينَ عَلَيْكِ الْمَاءَ فَتَطْهُرِينَ. It's enough for you to throw three handfuls of water over your head and then pour water over your entire self, and you'll be purified. The verse, فَالطَّهَرُ, they said it's broad and didn't specifically state that one must do wudu, dalk, or takhleel. I only mentioned dalk and wudu, not that it's the topic of today as it pertains to ghusl, But just to show you how the ulama use the proofs. The next issue is what's the sunnah and how takhlil is actually performed. In Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala said it's done with 10 fingers, not just 5, meaning not just with one hand. Ibn Daqiq al-Eid and al-Nasa'i said it's to run the fingers through the hair. And Ibn Daqiq al-Eid said taking the water with the fingers due to a narration that's on the authority of Aisha and Sahih Muslim, ثُمَّ يَأْخُذُ الْمَاءِ فَيُدْخِلُ أَصَابِعَهُ فِي أُصُولِ الشَّعْبِ. The messenger took water and put his fingers through the roots of the hair. They said that's clear, and it's a response for one who says put in only wet fingers alone. Meaning the sunnah is to take water with the fingers and rub the fingers to the roots of the hair, not just with the wet fingers. So to keep the train of thoughts going, the first issue we took so far is whether takhleel of the sha'r is sunnah or wajib. The second one is how takhleel of the sha'r is performed. Now, the next issue, is it done 3 times or once? The first opinion is that washing the head is 3 times, and that's the opinion of all 4 of the imams. With the Maliki having 2 opinions on this matter, the proof for the 3 times is the hadith in Bukhari by Aisha that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would pour water thrice. أَفَاضَ عَلَيْهِ الْمَاءَ ثَلَاثَ مَرَّاتٍ. He would pour water 3 times. Another narration, Sahih Bukhari, on the authority of Aisha, ثُمَّ يَصُبُّ عَلَى رَأْسِهِ ثَلَاثَ غُرَفٍ بِيَدَيْهِ. Then he would pour 3 handfuls of water over his head. In Sahih Muslim, in a hadith where the Sahaba were contending the issue of bathing among each other, and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was listening, one of them said, or some of them said, we wash our heads like this. They gave a certain way that they did. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, amma ana fa inni ufidu ala ra'si thalatha akuffin. As for me, the Messenger said, the way I do it, I pour 3 handfuls of water over my head. In Sahih Bukhari, in another narration, amma ana fa ufidu ala ra'si thalathan wa ashara bi yadayhi kiltayhima. He said, as for me, I pour water 3 times over my head. And he pointed with both of his hands. This narration is clear that he used both hands, and each time he poured it over his head. Sahih al-Bukhari, Hadith Jabir, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يأخذ 3 أكف ويفيضها على رأسه. The messenger took 3 handfuls and poured it over his head. The second opinion is the second opinion of the Malikiyya, and among them who adopted it is Al-Qadi Iyad, Al-Qurtubi, and Imam Malik himself in the Mudawwana. They said there's no certain number pertaining to washing the head. Once the head is fully wet and it reaches the root of the hair completely, that's all that's required. There's no certain specific number required. What about all those hadith? They said, yes, those hadith are in Bukhari, and they're in Muslim, and he poured over himself 3 times, as some of them apparently state. But there's no way you can prove every time he poured over his head, he encompassed the entire head. Ibn Rajab and Al-Qurtubi disputed among each other pertaining to the 3 pourings. They disputed among each other if each pouring encompassed the entire head, which is what Ibn Rajab adopted. And that would make it seem like he washed his head 3 times. Or if each time he poured over his head, it was to cover a portion of the head, and that's what Al-Qurtubi adopted. So one pouring on the right, and one on the left, and one over possibly the center of the head. In Al-Muntaqa lil-Baji and Al-Insaf lil-Mardawi, they said those ahadith can accept both interpretations and understandings. It's possible to indicate from those ahadith that he encompassed the entire head 3 times. So that would be 3 washings. Or they said, from those meaning of the hadith, it's possible that each one of the three washings was merely completing what he missed out, because the water may have not been sufficient from the first pouring. Meaning each pouring may have covered a certain part of the head. What he's saying, or what they're saying, is basically the hadith encompasses both interpretations. What may make or give washing the head once slightly additional weight is the fact that it coincides with the rest of the ghusl rituals. They're all one. Why would the head be an exception? Of course, apart from the hands, which is before the ghusl. The fourth mas'ala under the takhlil of the sha'r is if a man or a woman have a ponytail or braids. Must they undo the ponytail or braids? From my research, I believe I can summarize the opinions on four opinions. Summarize them in four opinions. The first opinion is the opinion of the three ulama, Malikiya, Shafi'iyya, and one of two opinions of the Hanabila. And that's that a woman doesn't need to undo her braids for washing after janaba or after menstruation. And a man with braids is just like that in his ghusl. The second opinion is the Hanafiya, and it's the opinion selected by al-Shawkani. They said a man must undo his braids, but not a woman. The third opinion is the second opinion by the Hanabila and the Zahiriyya, and some Malikiya adopted it, Ibn al-Qayyim adopted it, al-Hasan al-Basri in Tawus adopted it. They said for a woman after menstruation, she needs to undo her hair. In other ghusls, she doesn't need to. And they took it from, like Ibn al-Qayyim, he took it from the hadith of Salama. قُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِنِّي مْرَأَةٌ أَشُدُّ ضَفْرَ رَأْسِي فَأَنْقُدُهُ لِغُسْلِ الْجَنَابَةِ قَالَ لَا. I'm a woman who tightly plaited my hair on my head. Should I undo it for the ghusl? And she specified the ghusl after sexual intercourse. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said no. They said the question was clearly specific for janaba, not purification from menstruation. So that indicates there's a difference between the two. The fourth opinion is attributed to an-Nakhai, and that is that a woman must unbraid her hair in any type of ghusl. Out of all four opinions, the most accurate one is that both men and women don't need to undo the braids or the plaits so long as water reaches the scalp and in between the hair. Salama's hadith is very clear. إِنِّ مْرَأَةٌ أَشُدُّ ضَفْرَ رَأْسِ فَأَنْقُدُهُ لِغُسْلِ الْجَنَابَةِ قَالَ لَا. She said, I'm a woman with tightly plaited hair. Do I need to undo it for the ghusl after sexual intercourse? And the Messenger said no. In Sahih Muslim, another hadith by Aisha, that she heard Abdullah ibn Amr, كَانَ يَأْمُرُ النِّسَاءِ إِذَا اغْتَسَلْنَا أَنْ يَنْقُضْنَا رُؤُوسَهُمْ فَقَالَتْ يَا عَجَبًا لِبْنِ عَمْرٍ هَذَا يَأْمُرُ النِّسَاءَ إِذَا اغْتَسَلْنَا أَنْ يَنْقُضْنَا رُؤُوسَهُمْ أَفَلَا يَأْمُرُهُنَّ أَنْ يَحْلِقْنَا رُؤُوسَهُمْ لَقَدْ كُنْتُ أَغْتَسِلُ أَنَا وَرَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مِنْ إِنَاءٍ وَاحِدٍ ولا أزيد على أن أفرغ على رأسي ثلاث إفراغات. عائشة was informed that Abdullah ibn Amr was telling women to undo the plaits on their hair. She said, how strange is it for him to do that? He might as well go order them to shave their heads, the hair on their heads off. Me and the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to take a bath from one vessel, and I did no more than pour three handfuls of water over my head. From this hadith, you get two important things. The first one is that a woman doesn't have to undo her hair. Number two, that she doesn't need to undo it whether it's from the ghusl of janaba after sexual intercourse or whether it's after menstruation. How do we understand this and get this? The hadith doesn't specifically mention the ghusl of janaba or menstruation, but it mentions general ghusl. Aisha radiallahu anha was countering a claim by Abdullah ibn Amr that women must undo their plates. Now, had there been any difference, she would have mentioned it. Pertaining to ghusl of janaba or ghusl after menstruation, this would be the opportunity to mention it. But she didn't. She would have said he's wrong in this, but he's correct in this. In Sahih Muslim, the hadith related by Aisha, where Asma asked the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam pertaining to the ghusl from Hayd, the Messenger said, "Thumma tasubbu ala ra'siha fatadlukuhu dalkan shadidan hatta tablugha shu'una ra'siha." The woman should pour water on her head and rub it vigorously until it reaches the roots of the hair. If it was a rule, she must undo the hair. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have informed us. If he went through the detail of mentioning dalkan shadidan, vigorously rub it, and he mentioned the detail that it reaches the roots of the hair, hatta tablugha shu'una ra'siha, he mentioned those two extreme details, do you think he would leave out that she must also undo her hair? In Musannaf ibn Abi Shaybah, he related that Nafi' said, in a narration that appears to be authentic, that the wives of Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma and the mothers of his kids used to wash from janaba and hayd without undoing their braids. But they exaggerated in getting them wet, meaning they extensively went through the process of getting them wet. Another hadith is in At-Tabarani that the wives of the Messenger used to do ghusl, and it specifically states that they did not unbraid their hair. But that hadith is weak, and there's no need for it with all the other proofs that we mentioned. Another one is hadith Aisha. قالت كنا نغتسل وعلينا الضماد ونحن مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. We took a bath while having الضماد on our hair. الضماد is like an adhesive substance you put on hair. From what I read of its description, it appears to be something like something close to gel. In Awn al-Ma'bud, he said that al-dimad is the tight wrapping on the head, like a turban or something that they used when someone had a wound. They would wrap it tightly around the wound. But he said in this hadith, it's referring to an adhesive that they used to put with perfume on the hair. And it stays on, he said, because they didn't undo their braids. One more issue that needs responding to under this mas'ala is the opinion that makes a distinction between a woman's ghusl after menstruation and after other types of ghusl. They say for ghusl of hayd, she must undo her hair, but not for other types of ghusl. And they use the hadith in Sahih Muslim. Aisha radiallahu anha said, خرجنا مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عام حجة الوداع قالت فقدمت مكة وأنا حائض لم أطف بالبيت ولا بين الصفا والمروة فشكوت ذلك إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Aisha said, on the year of the Hajj of the Wada, we went to Mecca and I had my hayd. I didn't perform tawaf around the Kaaba, nor did I run between the Safa and the Marwa. So I told the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I complained to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Messenger said, "Unqudi ra'saki wamtashiti wa ahilli bil hajj wa da'i al umrah." Undo your hair, he said. Comb it and do the talbiyah for the hajj. How do we respond to that? Al-Shawkani rahimahullah said That's specific for the ihram of the Hajj. Ihram of the Hajj has a sunnah ghusl, and it needs extra cleaning. So that's for that. He said the fact that the Messenger said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, undo your hair and comb it, he combined undoing the braids with combing. No scholar considers combing wajib, which shows undoing the hair that's mentioned along with it is not wajib as well. Ibn Rajab gave an even, rahimahullah ta'ala, even a better response. He said, there's no proof that a woman must undo her braids in that hadith, because the ghusl that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Aisha radiallahu anha about was a ghusl of ihram that wasn't even for purification from hayd, because she was in the ongoing status of hayd. Ongoing. Her menstrual cycle was ongoing. She wasn't in ghusl purifying from it. Had her hayd been over and this ghusl was purification from the hayd, she would have done tawaf around the Kaaba and Umrah, which isn't what's stated in the hadith. Meaning, she took, what he's saying is, she took a ghusl for her ihram while on her hayd, while it was ongoing. So this ghusl is not ghusl from hayd, it's in, while she was in the process of the hayd. He was teaching her how to take a ghusl for the ihram of the hajj while her hayd was still ongoing. Another response is the fact that he told Aisha undo her hair in ihram can't be made to be a rule in every ghusl of purification from hayd. Why? Because it was only ordered in the ghusl of ihram. And ghusl of ihram isn't wajib. It's not a wajib ghusl like the ghusl of hayd. Ghusl for ihram is sunnah, while the ghusl for hayd is wajib. Another response is that Aisha radiallahu anha is the one who related the earlier hadith that we mentioned, the hadith of Asma, where the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Asma, and Aisha is the narrator, ثُمَّ تَغْسِلُ رَأْسَهَا وَتَدْلُكُهُ حَتَّى يَبْلُغَ الْمَاءُ أُصُولَ شَعْرِهَا. That's in Sunan Abu Dawud or in Sahih Muslim. Worded slightly different. ثُمَّ تَصُبُّ عَلَى رَأْسِهَا فَتَدْلُكُهُ دَلْكًا شَدِيدًا حَتَّى تَبْلُغَ شُؤُونَ رَأْسِهَا. The Messenger said, pour the water on the head and rub it vigorously until the water reaches the roots of the hair. The one who related that was Aisha radiallahu anha herself. There was no order in it to show that she must undo her hair or anything pertaining to distinguishing between the ghusl of janaba and the ghusl of the hayd. Just like her response to Abdullah ibn Amr, same thing. All that is what? So we won't lose our train of thoughts. That's in response to the opinion that a woman in ghusl of hayd needs to undo her hair, using the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha pertaining to the ihram, where the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam specifically told her to undo her hair. Another second proof for the opinion that says a woman must undo her hair or braids for ghusl of hayd, they use a weak hadith in At-Tabarani on the authority of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu that clearly states a woman must undo her hair for the ghusl of the hayd, but the problem with it is it's weak. Had it been authentic, it would have changed matters in this situation. A third rationale is in Al-Mughni for Ibn Qudama. He said, a woman should undo her hair so water can reach the scalp or root of the hair, because when it's braided, it's difficult to reach the roots. The response to that is the wajib part is to wash the hair to reach the scalp and the roots. And if that is achieved, that's all that needs to be done, whether the hair is braided or not. What's requested is that the water reach the roots. So you can request that, because the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam requested that. But if it's done while the hair is in braids, you can't request that. Finally, There's no authentic, clear proof on making a distinction between a man and a woman in this issue. No authentic, clear, explicit proof on that. The rajih from the arguments and counter-arguments and responses is very clear. It's what An-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala summarized in a paragraph. He said, if the water reaches the scalp, then a woman does not have to undo the braids. But if it doesn't, because of them, or for some reason pertaining to them, she must undo them. He said, as to the hadith of Salama, radiallahu anha, it's taken to mean a woman doesn't have to undo her braids, only if the water reaches the scalp or the roots of the hair. And he added that a man is like a woman in that. I'd like to finish the sunan of the wudu today, so we'll take the final one, which is وَغَسْلُ قَدَمَيْهِ فِي غَيْرِ مَوْضِعِهِ إِذَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مُبَلَّطًا. That's the seventh, actually that's the eighth one. Eighth and final one. Washing the 2 feet in another place if it's not paved or tiled. وَغَسْلُ قَدَمَيْهِ فِي غَيْرِ مَوْضِعِهِ إِذَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مُبَلَّطًا. When I mentioned the hadith of Maymuna radiallahu anha, not last week, but the week before that, I said we're going to refer back to these hadith frequently. And we did. I also, when I reached the part where the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Maymuna said, ثُمَّ تَنَحَّى عَنْ مَقَامِ ذَلِكَ فَغَسَلَ رِجْلَيْهِ in Sahih Bukhari Muslim, after he did the ghusl, Maymuna radiallahu anha said, the Messenger moved aside from that place and then washed his feet. I said, we'll explain that. The author's statement is his interpretation of that statement in Hadith Maymuna radiallahu anha. But it's part of a much more complex dispute on this matter, which is, when is it the sunnah to wash the feet? Should one do the limbs of wudu, then wash the feet with that? Or delay the washing of the feet, do the limbs of wudu, and then delay the washing of the feet until after the ghusl, or both times? The Hanafiya, Malikiya, Shafi'iyya, and Imam Ahmad said, you do the wudu for sunnah of ghusl, as we said, but you leave out the feet and wash them after the ghusl is over. The second opinion is you wash the feet with the wudu, Malikiya and Shafi'iyya, in another opinion of theirs. The third opinion is an opinion of the Hanabila to wash them with wudu and then repeat washing them after the ghusl, meaning you do them twice. In Kitab al-Furu' ibn Muflih, he mentioned the opinion that if the place is not clean, it's like muddy or dirty, then one should wash them after the ghusl. If it's a clean area, then you just wash them within the wudu, before the ghusl. And this is what the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, chose. Our author chose it because he said, washing the 2 feet in another place if the place is not tiled. وَغَسُّ قَدَمَيْهِ فِي غَيْرِ مَوْضِعِهِ إِذَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مُبَلَّطًا. The fifth opinion is that it's all the same. Washing the feet during wudu, before the ghusl, or delaying them until after is the same. And that was one of the opinions of the Hanabila. Let's mention some proof and figure out what the correct opinion is. The general proof for delaying the ghusl is ثُمَّ غَسَلَ سَائِرَ جَسَدِهِ ثُمَّ تَنَحَّى عَنْ مَقَامِهِ ذَلِكَ فَغَسَلَ رِجْلَيْهِ. The hadith that I mentioned. After the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam performed ghusl, Hadith Maymuna, she said, the Messenger moved aside from that place and then he washed his feet. The proof for the fifth opinion, that delaying washing the feet until after the ghusl or washing the feet within wudu is all the same, They said Hadith Aisha states that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam performed wudu, then did ghusl, and no mention of delay of washing the feet in it. Hadith Maymuna radiallahu anha states that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam moved from that place to another place and washed his feet after the ghusl. So the opinion says it's two different ghusls to show that you can do whatever you wish. They said Hadith Aisha, which doesn't specify he delayed washing the feet, and Hadith Maymuna that he delayed washing the feet, are two different ghusls. You choose whatever you want, whatever method you want. The proof for the fourth opinion that said it depends on if it's clear and clean area or if it's a dirty area, and it's what the author of the book chose, they took Hadith Maymuna radiallahu anha to be in that the ground was muddy or dirty. And if he didn't wash his feet somewhere else, they would have mud on them. And Hadith Aisha, they said, is when it's not muddy. Now we said, the messenger repeated washing the feet after he did the wudu to remove anything, any dirt on it, not nothing to pertaining to janaba. The third opinion is one of the opinions of the Hanabila to wash the feet in wudu and then repeat washing them after the ghusl. Their proof is Hadith Aisha in Sahih Muslim that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made wudu and specifically says wudu'ahu lis-salah, the wudu of the salah. Then he did ghusl, then he washed the feet. They said if he did wudu of the salah as it specifies, that means it's a full complete wudu and that includes the feet. Then at the end it says, ثم أفاض على سائر جسده ثم غسل رجلي. It means that he washed his feet again. Some ulama spoke about that addition in that hadith. They said that addition about the feet at the very, very end is weak. The rajih is that we got to keep in mind this entire wudu in ghusl is sunnah. So it doesn't affect the ghusl's validity. But as tulab ilm, we love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and we want to learn every detail about the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and more so apply it because of our deep love in imitating him. Also, we see how ulama analyze and dispute and rebuttal each other and how each has a various understanding of the same proof. So what's the rajah? I'll just give you what Imam Nawawi mentioned because it was very good and summarized. He said, based on the hadith of Aisha and Maymuna, the Shafi'i have two opinions. He said the weaker opinion within the Shafi'i madhab is making wudu but delaying washing the feet until after the ghusl. According to that weaker opinion, he said, they take the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha and most of the narrations of Maymuna radiallahu anha, where it says the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made wudu to mean most of the limbs of wudu except the feet, to coincide with the hadith Maymuna in Bukhari that specified clearly in that narration that he delayed washing his feet until after ghusl. He said the stronger opinion in the madhab of al-Shafi'iyyah is making full wudu prior to ghusl, including washing the feet. Now what we said, according to that opinion, making wudu prior to the ghusl, including the feet, its proof is the popular narrations of Aisha radiallahu anha and Maymuna radiallahu anha all together in making a full wudu, including the feet. A full wudu of salah means a complete full wudu, including the feet. Now we said, this is the majority of what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did, and that was his trend. But Nawawi now has to still explain how the hadith that states that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam washed his feet after ghusl, walked away, washed his feet after ghusl fits in. He has to explain that. So he said, the Messenger used to repeat washing the feet after ghusl to clean it from mud, not anything related to janaba. So according to that, the feet would be washed twice. The second washing of the feet has nothing to do with janaba, is just to wash any mud or dirt or sand off. And that's why our author, rahimahullah ta'ala, said, washing the 2 feet in another place, if it's not tiled or paved, وَغَسُّ قَدَمَيْهِ فِي غَيْرِ مَوْضُعِهِ إِذَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مُبَلَّطًا. We may have to go over this again if you didn't understand it. Maybe next week, inshallah. جزاكم الله خيرا وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.